بینندگان عزیز سلام، امیدوارم هر جای دنیا که هستید تا این لحظه رو به خوبی و خوشی پشت سر گذاشته باشید و اوقاتی رو که امروز چهارشنبه ششم ماه جون 2012 یا جوان 2012 برابر با 17 خرداد ماه 1391 با هم هستیم، اوقات بهتری پیش رو داشته باشید. امروز مهمانی رو دارم که قبلا قولش رو به شما داده بودم، ربای دیوید ایدنزون از نیویورک. ایشون من باهاش آشنا شدم، تلفنی با هم صحبت کردیم بعد از طریق اسکایپ و گفتم اگر مایل باشن با هم صحبت کنیم. در قسمت دوم برنامه ساعت 3 بعد از ظهر با خانم فیروزه غفارپور خواهیم بود تا در رابطه با جریانات ایران و دنیا با هم صحبتی داشته باشیم. چون آقای ربای دیوید ایدنزون فارسی صحبت نمی کنن، اجازه بدید بنده با همین انگلیسی شکسته و در هم ریخته بریم نیویورک با ایشون صحبت کنیم و شما اگر سوالی دارید میتونید تماس بگیرید، پیغام بذارید، من با شما تماس میگیرم یا در برنامه آینده پیامتون رو پخش میکنیم و در اون مورد توضیح میدیم. من باورم اینه که الان خیلی از ایرانی ها انگلیسی صحبت کردن رو بهتر از ماها که در خارج هستیم وارد هستن و بنابراین ما باید یه مقداری باز باشیم و خودمون رو محدود نکنیم. Alright, Rabbi, before I start my program, I would like to thank you for accepting my invitation, and on my behalf of my viewers and listeners, welcome you to MORDUN TV.
It's a very great honor to be here, and God bless you and your listeners for having the courage to invite someone like me here.
What, you mean we need the courage to do that?
We'll find out.
Alright, yeah, actually in these days you are 100% right, because people accuse you without having evidence or something and they say whatever they like. Rabbi, we all know that different religions, they say different things and people are kind of confused, to be honest with you. But your religion is one of the oldest ones. If we don't say the oldest, is one of the oldest one. How many years Jews and Jewish was existed, and when they started? Can you give us a little bit about history of how it started, when, and by whom?
Well, Jewish history goes with the Bible, so we're now in biblical years. We're in the year 5,700, and we believe that the world will last 6,000 years. So we're coming to the end, which will be the Messianic year. That's our belief. And of those 5,700 years, the official Jewish religion began around the year 2000, with Abraham. But when Abraham found God, he was not the main priest in the world. The main priests in the world, from the time of Adam, which goes back to the year 1, they were not Jews. There was 2,000 years where there were no Jews at all in the world, and the main prophet then was somebody called Shem, the son of Noah. So Noah was a righteous man. Every generation, there were about 10 generations from Adam to Noah. From Adam to Noah were 10 generations. Every generation had some righteous person, despite the fact that most people were running in different directions, in the wrong directions. But there was always some prophet to keep things going. And then the flood came. And then the next 10 generations was Abraham. It began with Abraham and the Jewish people. So the Jewish people, as a religion, traces itself to Abraham, but Abraham, even in his own time, was not the major prophet in the world. It was a non-Jew. It was a Gentile, the son of Noah. So therefore, the fact that the Jews have this special relationship with God was not that they were chosen to necessarily be the right one, but Abraham was the only one that was able to train his family to follow God's way, and the rest of the world wasn't interested. So God chose Abraham, and some generations after Abraham, there was about 500 years after Abraham, God gave the Torah, to the law, to the Jewish people at Sinai. He gave the Ten Commandments to the Jews at Sinai. So this was the first time that there was such a thing as the Jewish religion actually given by God to the Jewish people and to Moses, the greatest of the prophets. So the Jewish religion, as we know it today, really begins from Moses, when he brought down the Bible and the Torah. The Torah is the law of God from Sinai, and that was around the year 2448 after the creation, and we're now in the year 5700, so we see that was a few thousand years ago. And this law was a written law that we have the Bible, and there was an oral law that was handed down for many generations, and people were required to memorize it. And later on, this oral law was put into the Talmud and various books. So today, we don't expect people to memorize these books. We don't have that kind of strength and ability. So we have books that are printed, and we have the oral law printed, and we have the written law printed. And but basically, the religion that I practice is exactly the same religion practiced by Moses, and my relationship with God is exactly that of Abraham. But the fact is that there were 20 generations before Abraham of great people, and there are still many great people. You don't have to be Jewish, as the rabbis taught, that a Gentile who has the right purity of heart can have the Holy Spirit descend on them.
Okay, Rabbi, you mentioned 10 commandments. If that commandments are enough, why we should go with, another book? And how many different books you have?
Well, we have around 60 volumes in the Talmud on different subjects. For instance, there's a book about the Sabbath, there's a book about getting married, a book about getting divorced, all types of different topics that are important to people comprise books in the Talmud. And then we have other kind of books. We have in the written law in the Bible, and we have in the oral law studies on how to be a better person, how to be closer to God, without specifically doing a certain religious act, but just that you should be more of a person. This is a very, very central thing called Derech Eretz, to know how to be human. And being human is even higher and more important than keeping the actual rituals. So a person who doesn't behave like a person is not even human, and he has nothing to do with Torah and religion. But a person who does keep what is known as Derech Eretz, the humanity, and he acts like a person, is supposed to act to other people and to God, so that's a person. Then the person starts thinking, if I'm a human being, I'm acting like a human being, then let me turn to religion and see what the rituals are.
Okay. You keep mentioning Bible. I thought your book is Torah. Why you call it Bible?
Well, in Hebrew, it's Torah, which means light. But if you want to discuss about the holy works, so in the secular world, you tell someone Torah. Torah means so many things. You have to be specific. When you say the word Bible, he knows what you're talking about. There's a Bible. There's the five books of Moses, and there's the books of book of Joshua and history, and there's the prophets screaming at the Jews for sinning. There's all types of books in the Bible, but the books that were selected to be the permanent eternal works of the Bible, that's Torah, and the Torah is divided into three essentially: Torah, Nevi'im, and Ksuvim. Torah is the five books of Moses. That's what it's generally referred to. All the Torah means everything, but when we say the word Torah, relative to the other books in the Bible, we mean the five books of Moses. But then the other parts of the Bible, the Nevi'im, the prophets such as Isaiah and Habakkuk and various prophets. And then we have Ksuvim, writings, holy writings such as the book of Psalms. Book of Psalms is holy writings. The book of Proverbs, holy writings written by Solomon. So these books are the third section of what is known as the Bible. And in the Torah, we call that, we don't say Bible, we say Tanakh. Tanakh is an acronym. Torah, Nevi'im, Ksuvim. The five books of Moses, Torah, Nevi'im, prophets, and Ksuvim, the holy writings.
Okay, Rabbi, what is the difference between regular Jews and Jewish people with Zionists or those that they, you know, started what they call it, something like a party as a Zion, and they follow some rule. Are you consider yourself a Jew or Zionist or what?
Well, every Jew can take the word Zionism or a Zionist to mean a loving for Israel, a loving for Zion, because the word Zion and Sion is a biblical word. It goes back thousands of years. It was not invented in 1948. It's been around for thousands of years. Now, what happened was that when the Zionist movement rose up, the actual Zionist movement founded by Theodor Herzl was a very violent attack on the whole belief of religion. Because he said, forget about God, forget about the Messiah, forget about religion, what we have to do is solve the Jewish problem. And he, at that time, was in a very depressing age, in the 19th century, when people started thinking there's never going to be an end to Jewish suffering, and the Tsar was torturing people, and the Jews figured there's no solution. So Herzl came up with the idea, he will convert all the Jews to Christianity, there won't be any more Jews anymore, and just for old time's sake, he will be the only remaining Jew left in the world. So he was a nut. So unfortunately, he was another genius, and he was able to make a huge movement. But the fact is, even though he was a nut, and even though the ideas he had were ridiculous, but nonetheless, he was a great journalist and a speaker, and he had a magnetic personality. And the people were so desperate that secular Jews grabbed onto him that maybe we could do something. Those were the days when people were desperate. Some became communists, some became this, some became that, some became Zionists. Now, people like me, we don't need Theodor Herzl. We have our Zionism that was taught by Moses and taught by Abraham. And what that means is that we believe in Zion. We believe in Zion as the birthplace of Torah, that this is where God's presence is. And the holy city of Jerusalem, the holy land of Israel, these things have nothing to do with what is called today Zionism. Zionism was a creation by Theodor Herzl of a person who denied God, who wanted to do away with all Jews and convert them, and he would remain the only last Jew. He was an idiot. But the fact is that he may have done things and got things moving that some people give him credit for founding what is today the state of Israel. Now, others will say the whole thing is a pure miracle. But till this day, with the use of Zionism, the word Zionism is used quite freely. No one has a monopoly what the word means. And in Israel today, although, say, when I visited Israel the first time when I was around 20, so I went out on the Sabbath, I was in the yeshiva, I studied in the yeshiva there, and then somebody came over to me and he stuck his hip out. His hip had a wallet in it. He wanted to insult me to show me that he didn't care about the Sabbath because he didn't want religious Jews there. A lot of people there, that's the type of Zionists that were not tolerant of religious people. And I once went for a walk and I walked into a cul-de-sac somewhere. A little kid came out with a knife and I just looked at him. So he took the knife and he sliced his finger. He says, it's very sharp. So he thought I was going to run away because they taught kids that religious people run away. So I didn't run away, and his mother came out just in time. She said, get in the house right away. That was then. Now what has happened now, after the Yom Kippur War, all these people were thrown out. These people with their crazy ideas about there's going to be a secular Judaism and all this kind of stuff that began with Theodor Herzl, Golda Meir and Ben Gurion, all these people they lost standing. And Begin began a new phase when there was a lot more religion than the old secular anti-religion. And every year it gets stronger and stronger. Today, the Haredi, the ultra-Orthodox presence, which believes in the Messiah and believes in God without any changes, we're not interested in what Herzl had to say or what Ben Gurion had to say, but the people like us are completely committed to the Torah, and we're growing rapidly to the extent where Israel in the near future will have a majority of Orthodoxy And even a very high percentage of the Orthodox will be people like me, Haredi, very ultra-Orthodox. And this is the major problem in Israel today, because you have two countries. You have the secular and you have the religious. And the secular are their children are becoming religious, because they see there's nothing. There's never going to be peace. How can you have peace? Never going to be peace. So all the dreams, the people had, they said, Ben-Gurion and others thought, the Zionists, they said, all we have to do is eat pork and not act like religious Jews, and the Gentiles will love us. And people like me say, where did you come from? What kind of world are you from? You really think that people are going to love Jews for any reason at all? It doesn't do any good to do these things. So after Herzl, and many people believed like him, that's what happened in Germany. The people actually believed the secular Jews, they said, let's try to imitate the Christians, then they'll love us. So what happened? They turned them into soap. So this is something that people like always knew this was going to happen. You cannot invent a Jew that everybody's going to love. We're a Jew, we're Jewish people. People don't necessarily love us. And the solution to us is the coming of the Messiah. And he's going to come soon, and we believe in God. And the other stuff, we believe in something else. One more thing, an ultra-Orthodox rabbi who died in the Second World War, just at the end of the war he died, he wrote a book about Zionism from a religious perspective. And he said, he interpreted, he was a great genius and a great rabbi, and he took all the literature, a fantastic work, and he said, the Jewish people are going to come to Israel, and the people that were built will not be religious, and they'll come to Israel to destroy religion. But these very same people, when they come to Israel and they're involved with the holiness of the soil and the land, and they defend it, whatever it is, he said, these people are going to rebuild the land, and this will be the precursor of the coming of the Messiah. And ultimately, all Jews will return to God. And this was his book. He was murdered just before the end of the war. But this was his idea, what he thought. And the fact is that we see that in Israel today, things unimaginable in my time when I was young, the negative attitudes that people have today, everybody knows that the only game in town left is Orthodoxy, and in Orthodoxy, it's the ultra-Orthodox that are the strongest and the fastest growing religion in the world.
Rabbi, I have to ask you to do me a favor and shorten your answers, because we have so many questions. During your talk, I also showed your website, one of them. You are very active and you have so many websites. The one I was showing was Secret of the Scale, that they can open it like secretscale.com. We will talk about the other one, and one of them was very interesting for me. What was the name? Jews Haters?
JewHaters.com.
JewHaters.com. And Rabbi, somebody asked me, sent me email, asked about the hat, why you cover your head, and why all the religion, almost all the religions, ask even men to cover their head. What is in it? What's behind this hat, or what they call it? The small hat that you put on.
Yarmulke.
Yeah. Explain about that a little bit to we understand what is the philosophy behind it.
The Talmud talks about this. The Talmud says, cover your head so you should have fear of God. That is, a religious person feels not that God is something way out there that I'll meet in 120 years when I die, I'll go fly up there and meet God. We believe that God is with us every second. God is constantly watching us, and God is constantly pumping our life into us every second. And out of a sign of respect to God, we cover our heads, because this gives us a fear of God. We're always reminding ourselves there's somebody above us.
Oh, okay. All right. I'm sure you know some rabbi in New York. I believe one of them is Rabbi Wise, that they do believe in their book. Jews were told that you never should have a country or a land, and you always should be like homeless or something like this. Do you know them, and are you familiar with their philosophy and what they are after?
I am familiar to some degree. There is a group called the Turi Karta, and what happened was when the Zionist movement began, the general Orthodox community shunned it. There were some in the Orthodox community that tried to break bread with them somehow, to work with them, in the hope that they would become original, ultimately to accept some kind of religious influence. But the ultra-Orthodox didn't have anything to do with them. There was very, very great differences of opinion. Now, what happened, we have a state now, people live there, and there's different ways of approaching it. Some people could say, well, the Messiah is not here, so we want nothing to do with the state. And let's go in to the Arabs and say, look, we want you to control the land. And people like myself don't agree to this. We feel that to do the kind of things they're doing, you have to be a prophet to know that God wants this or that. We don't know exactly what God wants. But we do know that there's a lot of people out there that hate our guts and would do anything to destroy us. And just to work with them and try to undermine the safety of millions of Jewish people living in Israel, we think that's a very wild thing, and we're absolutely against it. The vast majority of Orthodox rabbis do not feel we're prophets, and we are able to do the kind of things that these people are doing. There is a positive thing from it, however, that there are a lot of people in the Arab world who see these people and say, well, all Jews are not bad. Maybe there are some that have good ideas. But this is a type of a thing in the pre-Messianic era that we don't have any prophets, and we don't know exactly what God wants out of us. And so therefore, this one says this one says that. I know my mentors were the greatest rabbis in the world, and even the ones like the Satmar Rebbe, who was the greatest opponent of Zionism, the very greatest one of his time, opponent of Zionism, he didn't tell people, he did not allow his disciples to do the kind of things Rabbi Weiss does.
Thank you so much. One of our viewers from Texas wrote an email, and he's asking, could you please talk about, in Daniel prophecy says 1260 years from cleansing the sanctuary, Messiah will return. Is that true?
I don't want to talk about that, because the book of Daniel is something anybody can invent what he thinks out of it. And many good and idealist, even great rabbis, have made all types of teachings and hoax, whatever it is. And a lot of them saw that their ideas didn't pan out. The book of Daniel is something we can read. And when we have a feeling, without prophets telling us the real interpretation of the book of Daniel, they can feel what they want to feel. But to get up and talk about the book of Daniel and say, this is what Judaism teaches, or this is what the book of Daniel teaches, this is irresponsible.
Thank you so much. People are asking about Purim, and I refer them to the video that you have on your website, and I will show your website right now. It's very simple. It says secretscale.com, and all of your videos are over there. But somebody asked if it's possible, either today or some other day, read from the book, especially that page or that paragraph that talk about that event or that incident or whatever you call it, between Persian and Jewish people in Iran, that you guys call it Purim, and some people believe it was like killing 70,000 Iranian or 7,000 Iranian. Do you want to talk about that, or can you read from your book today, or you think you can do it some other time?
I'd be very happy to talk about it now. I remember when I published that that video, this got a lot of comments on YouTube, and there were people who felt, as you mentioned, that in their history, this time of Purim was a time of killing Persians. And so I asked them a very simple question. How was it that the Jews, who were slaves basically in Babylonia, and then it was the Jewish slaves were taken over by the Persian kings, how did these people suddenly get up to go murder 70,000 people? What happened to the police? What happened to the army? What happened to the mighty Persian army? At this time of Purim, The Persian army was the mightiest army in the world. And come along a few kikes, you'll forgive me, you know, but I'm just saying how silly it is. Come along a few Jews and they're going to kill 70,000 people and knock off the police and the army. It's ridiculous. That's a stupid story. It could never have happened, such a thing. Imagine in New York City when there's hundreds of thousands of Orthodox Jews. If they wanted to kill somebody, why, they would be put in jail in a second. I mean, they'd be shot. They wouldn't get around killing 70,000 people. You're going back to a country thousands of years ago when the Jews, and the Purim story, they were a nation that the king himself signed the letter to destroy them all. They had no rights. They're going to get up and suddenly wipe out 70,000 people. It's ridiculous to think that. But the story as is taught in the book of Esther, the story is very simple. That the king and Haman, his prime minister, were very happy to murder out all the Jews. And the king signed the paper, kill out all the Jews in Persia. But then he wanted a wife because he killed his first wife. So the second wife, he had a beauty contest and he found some woman, she happened to be Jewish, and he married her. Not because he liked Jews, but because he thought she was beautiful. So when he married her, so she managed to turned things around that he killed Haman, and he put her uncle in his place, Mordechai. But the edict that the king had made to wipe out the Jews, the king said it's against Persian law to do anything with that decree. I've signed it. It has the royal signet. I can't do anything about it. On the day of Purim, whatever it is, that day, then the anybody who wants to take a knife and kill a Jew. So Esther started crying, says, you want me to be killed, I'm your wife. So he said, well, that's something to think about. He says, I'll tell you what, I'll make your second decree. I can't do anything about the first decree. That's it. Whoever wants to kill you on that day can do it. That's the Persian law. But I'll make another law. Whoever, if you want to defend yourself, you can defend yourself. So he made that decree. Whoever attacks the Jews fight back. That's the law. They can fight back. So those that wanted to kill the Jews said, I'm going to take my chances. They knew that a Jew was the queen. They knew their Jew was the prime minister. And they knew this prime minister probably had a lot of influence on the police. But they said, we hate Jews so much, we're going to kill the Jews anyway. We're going to risk our lives. And they risked their lives. And they figured out a bunch of Jews, a bunch of kikes, they're going to fight. They didn't know how to fight. They've been slaves for 70 years. So there was a terrible fight, and the Jews were not exactly soldiers or trained in the martial arts. And yet, for some reason, the Jews knew that this is the end of the line for them, that they're going to kill their wives and their children, and they fought back. And there were horrible battles, and the king let them fight it out. And when they fought it out, there were a lot of dead Persians. So this. We believe this was a miracle that a bunch of Jews don't know anything about fighting. I mean, just imagine a person like me would pick up a stick and go fight with a trained policeman. I'd be dead in a second. But yet, these Jews, they went out and fought people that evidently they were comfortable using weapons. But they were, thousands of them were killed. So this is a story that, and it's the only story that makes sense. The idea that Jews in exile, who were slaves yesterday, they suddenly get up and step on people and kill 70,000 of them while the police just watch and the army just watches. That's ludicrous.
Thank you so much. Somebody called and asked me to ask you this question. Do you know yourself better people than others? Is that true that in your book you were told that you are the chosen people and Jews are the only one that goes to heaven and the rest will be punished or something like this?
This is absolutely a lie. The Torah makes it very clear. In fact, I just read something today about the fact that there's the book of Elijah the prophet has a whole thing there. It says that that Gentiles who are pure of heart and serve God, they can have the Holy Spirit rest on them. Of course, there'll be Gentiles in the future world. And the question then is, why are the Jews the chosen people? Chosen for what? So the idea is that a Jew, just like you walk into a synagogue, there's a rabbi and there's a community. So in the Jewish people, the priests were not allowed to own land. That is not that they weren't allowed to, but they weren't given any land. Everybody else had land, the farms, they worked on it. The priests were busy with priestly activities. And what was the priestly activities? They had very, very difficult jobs in the temple. They were not allowed to wear shoes, and they had constant stomach problems, and they had to eat all types of food that didn't make them particularly healthy. This is the priesthood, and among the rabbinic priesthood, people that are not priests, but people who are scholars. And the Talmud says most of them were sick. Now, I don't say I'm sick. I'm not such a wonderful scholar to be sick. In those days, that the scholars spent so much time learning and working that they ended up sick. So the priesthood are people that gave up this world, and they suffered. Either they had stomach trouble or they were sick or whatever. They didn't have money, and they struggled very hard. So the idea is that Jewish people ideally are supposed to be dedicated to spirituality, to the sense that the rest of the world will make the money and the rest of the world will deal with the material things. And the Jews will be the people of spirituality. This is the ideal, what God wanted for the Jewish people, to be a mamleches kohanim, a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. It doesn't mean the Jews have power. It doesn't mean the Jews are going to take over the world. It means just the opposite. If you're a priest, then you suffer. And the Jewish people, ideally, should be involved with spirituality. And unfortunately, they never accepted this challenge properly. And because of that, the rest of the world is left in darkness. Because we never got to the point where we even perfected ourselves. We ourselves are full of sins, unfortunately, and we weren't able to take care of the rest of the world. So the rest of the world, they also have souls. Every human being has a soul. Every human being senses there's a God. So they said, what are we supposed to do? How do we relate to this God? So this one came along, and this one came along, and there's hundreds and thousands of different versions of what you're supposed to do. And why is there such a mess? Because the Jews didn't do their job.
Thank you so much. You are very talkative, and I like to hear that we were supposed to speak about 30 minutes, maximum to 40 minutes for today. Let me ask you the last question. In some religions, we see if somebody leave that religion, they may say he should be killed, or the punishment is capital punishment, something like this. Also, some religions said you should be born in that religion to be part of that. What is the rule and law in Jewish religion? If I am a Jew today and tomorrow I decide to go somewhere else, is there any punishment waiting for me? Or if I'm not a Jew today, what can I do to become a Jew tomorrow?
Any person born as a Jew or converted to be a Jew is a Jew and can't change it. If a person is not born a Jew, they can convert. And this is a very delicate thing, because once you become convert, you can't change yourself. We had a fellow here in Muncie, where I live. He was a veteran of Vietnam, and he grew up in Muncie. And Muncie gradually used to be a farming area with apple trees. And he was the last one that had an apple orchard, this family. And so he was influenced by all the Judaism going along, and he decided he wants to be Jewish. And he went to rabbis, and they said, no, he's a young kid. They know he'll be a Jew for a year, and then he's going to quit. So he made a campaign, and he went to all the restaurants and all the Jewish places and hung up signs. Why don't the rabbis want me? This went on for a couple of years. So finally somebody converted him. And he lasted about a year or two, and then he quit. So this is one of the very great problems we have. People that are very anxious to be Jewish, and then it's too hard. It's very hard to be Jewish. And it's not something to be encouraged. And therefore, I have a website, TorahUniversal.com, for people that are not Jewish, but they want to see the Jewish ideas for non-Jews, which are called Noahide laws. So I have a website there, TorahUniversal.com. There are many people throughout the world who are not Jewish, but they can deal with rabbis as Noahides. But they're not. They don't have to keep all the laws that I have to keep. They have a few basic laws: not to steal, not to murder, a few other things. And they can come to the highest level of spirituality, but they don't have the Jewish level, which is a very, very hard level.
But you said they cannot leave. If they leave, what will happen?
A Noahide is not Jewish. A Noahide is a Noahide, so he's always supposed to be a Noahide. But a Jew, but if he converts to Judaism, Noahide is not conversion to Judaism. Noahide means a person is not Jewish, but he has a relationship with God and he goes to heaven. But a Jewish means he has a very hard law. The Jewish law is very, very hard, and the rabbis always discourage conversions because it's very, very hard. It's hard for people that the parents and their grandparents were religious. It's very hard for them to keep the laws. But to take someone that was raised as a Gentile and he had delicious shrimp and bacon and tell him you can't eat this and you can't eat that, then who knows what else. There's so many difficult laws. We definitely discourage conversion. But if someone does decide to go convert, many of them are successful, but some of them quit. But we don't accept the quitting. We say the person remains a Jew.
But let's forget about those that they converted. Let's talk about somebody that he or she was born Jewish. If he or she decided to, you know, get out of that, what punishment will be waiting for them? And who will, you know, do that punishment? Who is responsible to make sure he get that punishment?
That's a very interesting point. I like to talk about it all the time. I say like this. We're all going to come before God in 120 years. And they're going to have a whole list of people. They're going to say here's a Nazi that he took a baby and smashed his head against the wall. They say, okay, fellow, you have to go to Gehenna, the other world. So I'll say, what do you want? I grew up in Germany, and Luther was the priest. And he taught you have to do that to Jews, and why am I going to go to Gehenna? So they say, yeah, that's a point. I'll say, look, everybody in my town believed Jews had to have their baby's head smashed against the wall. Well, why are you going to send me to Gehenna? So they're going to wrestle with that problem. That's a terrible problem. So to make a long story short, what are they going to do? They're going to say, no one goes to Gehenna. It's just my joke. It's a stupid joke. It's a horrible joke, but it's not really funny. And so my joke is like this. So all these people that are evil, that killed Jews and did everything else, they're going to say, look, you grew up in such a world, and the priest taught you to do this, and the Protestant preachers taught you to do that, and the Muslim leaders, everybody says go kill a Jew. Everybody said it. So how can you blame anybody? So none of these people should go to Gehenna for this. But there's one person should go to Gehenna, who? It's R Eidensohn, because he should have gone and made a video and taught people about the right way. And since he obviously didn't do it, so he'll go to Gehenna.
Okay, Rabbi, if people want or like to contact you, what is the best way to do it?
They can send an email to me at media@secretscale.com. media@secretscale.com. I'd be very happy to hear from anyone.
Yeah, they don't have to be part of media, because it was kind of confusing for me when you put media. I thought this is just for press and media contact. It's for everybody.
It's an email. If they want to, they can. That's the email that I have for people who want to contact me.
All right. For now, there is no phone call or connecting by phone. Yeah. To you.
Well, let's start out with the email and. If somebody wants to, okay, I'll give you my phone number.
No, you don't have to give it if you are not comfortable. Let's start with, you know, the email. If you feel this is something that you needed, then we go ahead with phone. Last question, very quickly, please. If somebody wants or like to get married with somebody that he's or she's not Jewish, what is the rule and law about it?
You mean can a Jew marry a non-Jew?
Yeah.
No.
What they should do? Somebody convert to the other religion?
I don't have any advice for this. I did make up the laws. I could just stay with the laws. The law is that a Jew is not allowed to marry someone outside of the faith, and people that, like my children, I am sensitive to that, so I make sure to get my children married the right way, so when they're young, they're married up, and they don't start thinking about a thousand things. When you start getting older and you start thinking a thousand things, then there's very big problems in that. So this is one of the problems.
But you said they should marry the right way. You mean the other ways are wrong?
I mean that young people with the parents involved, like, you know, my children, I married my children off when they were young, And I did all the work. I found for them people that I knew would be good for them. And then they met them. And if they liked it, if they liked each other, good. If not, not. But today, when people are older and they go out on their own, they really don't have an effective way to get married. And they're always making mistakes, and there's a huge divorce rate. So today, in the United States, 51% of eligible people are married, and people are getting tired of marriage, and 50% of women under 30 are having babies without wedlock, without getting married. So the whole marriage industry is declining and disappearing. In deeply religious communities, such as in my community, where the parents do the job and do the work, and get the children organized at a young age, and make sure they're going to find the right people to be happy with, so then marriage can be very successful. And they can have children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren like I do, and you're thrilled with everything that comes along. But the outer world is such a mess, and there's such forces that militate against marriage, that you have all these things. The worst thing in the world, in terms of marriage stability, is to marry someone from a different religion. It just plain stupid. Because there's so much divorce now, that's even when people have the same religion, the same background, but to go look for trouble when there's such divorces and marriage is failing so badly, to go marry somebody from a different religion is ridiculous.
Rabbi, thank you so much. I also showed your website, and down there people that can watch the videos. You have some video about family, about wedding, about relation between couples. I encourage them to go over there and watch them, and if they have any question, contact you by email media@secretscale.com, or they can send me email. I will forward it to you. They can leave a message for you and I put the number on the screen, and I'm looking forward to have you more often, maybe in near future. You just talk with audience without me being involved, and we cut the he said and she said off.
Let me just say that I have a YouTube, youtube.com, MONS5555, with 232 videos there. You'll generally get a better video on that than on my website. Thank you very much. It's a very big honor to be here.
Thank you so much, and as I said, I hope we both see better days. Let's hope for better days.
Okay, I'm sure. God bless you and your listeners, and thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.